there.
Okay, I can talk loud. I found in my life, the worst thing that ever happened to me was we were through the eye of Hurricane Andrew and literally lost everything. And at the moment, we were devastated. Our first response was, God, why could you let this happen to us? I can now look back on that, and it was 100% blessing. Because what came from that, learning that so many things were materialistic, you don't need all that. The growth that it brought with people coming together and turning their focus towards God. That Sunday when we went to Mass, even though our sanctuary was in pretty bad shape, we couldn't meet in there, we walk out and there's a rainbow over it. And it shows that God has to let things happen, but He can turn them around if you're open to looking for the good in the situation instead of just, you know, thinking God was wrong to me or something and like that.
Thank you. That's beautiful. And maybe, you know, maybe that's the struggle of faith. Yeah, that issue. God prevents evil. And when you're talking about something like your experience, I would say probably many here would echo in their own experience as something that would, you know, go along and agreeing with that. That aspect of evil, we can understand. God permits evil. God doesn't cause evil. God permits evil. Because if God caused evil, that's the opposite of who God is. God is love. So God doesn't cause evil. But the issue becomes with that, and I'm taking what you're saying and bringing a bigger issue, is when we see that evil that we can't quite put words to it, we say, how could anything come out? In other words, last night, 50 people were gunned down from the 32nd floor of Mandalay Bay in Las Vegas by a crazy person who stood there firing a submachine gun, and over 200 were injured. You say, well, that's evil. God permitted that, so something good could come. Why the hell would God allow something like that to happen? See, I mean, that's where I think the confusion at times comes, because if God is a loving God, then how can a loving God allow innocent people who just went to a concert to enjoy a concert never to come home because some nutcase killed them? And that's where, in my mind, two things take place. First of all, most of the evil in the world isn't because of some mysterious thing. Most of the evil in the world is because of what we do to one another. Secondly, we have the ability to change that. God permits free will. If God interferes in our free will, in other words, we say, well, God, I want you to let this be just like it is, but I want you to change this. How many times, you know, we pray, God, change this, do that, do that, do this, do this. That if God interferes with our free will, then what happens to our free will? Then we just become puppets, where there is no free will. So actually, the scripture, the word of God teaches us, God has given us free will, but if we walk with the Lord and allow God into our free will, then our free will is used for good, not for evil. But that's always cooperating with the grace of God. So in a sense, as you walk through that, you were cooperating with the grace of God to see something good come out of something that was. Yes?
9/11 was a terrible thing. It was a tragedy for everyone. And yet my daughter and son-in-law, my daughter gave birth to a baby boy on 9/11. And just the nicest, the sweetest, the smartest kids you ever want to meet. And yet, you know, watching it on television, I cry. I mean, I was just so frustrated and so upset about who would do this. And then that night we got a call that she delivered, you know, 6 days early on 9/11. So again, something, so there were 50 babies born on that day, I found out. 50 babies born on 9/11 throughout the country. And it just, it kind of offsets a little bit what the tragedy was.
Or even when you something like that, how many times? I spent a lot of time walking through the halls of the Pentagon, and because it was just down the street from where I was stationed at Fort Myer, and I had a lot of people there, and I did a lot of different ceremonies there. And there's still a lot of people there who were in that building on 9/11. So, you know, just even walking with them, they were involved, a lot of them were involved in the rescue efforts of getting people out of the building, et cetera. Yeah, again, you know, what at the moment, what we see dimly now is in a mirror, then we shall see face to face. When we're so close to something, can't even imagine anything good coming out of that when we step back, you know. Yes, sir.
So you just talked a moment about,
speak up
louder than this. You just talked a moment about evil done by people, okay? And I was asked years ago, and I didn't have a good answer for why God would permit such great suffering in the world. Sure, there were 2,000 or 3,000, whatever it was, but right now there are hundreds and hundreds of millions of people greatly impoverished, diseased, and so on. How can a loving God allow his children to suffer so?
Well, he doesn't want them to, but you and I can change that tomorrow.
But he permits it.
He permits it, but he doesn't cause it. And because he gives us, we already, there's no, again, I mean, I'll admit it of myself. You know, it's the same thing as this. We could pay off the national debt right now if we committed ourselves and said, I'm going to give half my salary back to paying off the national debt. If every American in this country said that, we pay off our national debt, we'd be back to zero. We wouldn't be in debt. But then what do we say? We say, well, I'm not doing it unless you do it. And then you say, I'm not doing it unless you do it. And then you say, I'm not going to do something like that because they're just going to throw the money away and waste it. And so why the hell should I do something like that? You know what I'm trying to say? To me, it's the same kind of thing. All the starvation in the world, all the poverty in the world could go probably away. I'm not going to say tomorrow, but maybe within 2 years if we made changes within ourselves. Again, look at where is most of the wealth in this world. Most of the wealth in this world is in within us. We don't look at ourselves like that. We say, well, I don't have $1 billion in my bank account. I'm not wealthy. But compared to 9/10 of the world, we are very wealthy. So it's the sacrifices that we are willing to make so that someone else can be different. You do that, I have no doubt. Again, that a number of you probably have made little sacrifices here and there for someone else. It might have been your son or your daughter lost their job. You took them in, you took the whole family, you took the whole family in to live with you. You took care of the food bill, you took care of this, you took care of that until they could get their feet back on the ground. Now, it might not have been that, but something like that on some kind of situation. You made that sacrifice, and because of that, they were ultimately able to get back to some kind of semblance of thing. I say in the bigger sense, gigantic sense, in terms of the world. And then look at a lot of those countries. It's multifaceted. A lot of those countries, there's a lot of corruption in those countries. And a lot of that money doesn't go to the people. It goes to a few people who take the money and put it in bank accounts in Switzerland, you know. Again, that stuff, all that stuff we can change. So to me, we lay on God a lot of things where we need to take responsibility for the differences that we can make. I will say, though, and then I'll come back to you. You do know there's a mystery that I never probably could answer on this side of life. That it's again something that I could only see from the other side as to what that meant. But I just know we can make a difference in things by what we do. Yes, sir. Keep going.
And so.